You're watching the award-winning GHS-TV, a nationally recognized student television station.
Hello, and welcome to this week's edition of GHS-TV's award-winning talk show, Crosstalk. I'm your host, Sara Mayers. Each week in this time slot, we take a look at different issues, personalities, and events that affect you and our community. If you're one interested in the medical field, you don't necessarily have to go across the country or even out of state to get your degree. The Mid-South, but particularly here in Memphis, has numerous colleges that offer a stellar education in the field of medicine. Today we will hear from some of the medical research colleges and universities close to home to give you insight on their programs and the field as a whole. On the set now, we have Dr. John Covington, the Associate Dean of Admissions and Student Affairs for the University of Tennessee Health Science Center Department of Dentistry. Mr. Covington, thank you for being on the show today.
Well, thanks for the invitation.
Well, the College of Dentistry is one of the oldest in the country. Tell us about how it got started.
It did. It started first in Nashville. It's the oldest school in the South, formed in 1878, and the third oldest in our nation. Our reputation is for excellence in clinical dentistry. The academic dentist is not our forte. Clinical dentistry is.
How did it get started, and when did it get started? It
got started about 150 years ago. It's moved around from Nashville to Memphis as the Health Science Center was consolidated here. But we have outreach clinics in seven different areas of Tennessee.
Well, the Health Science Center is known for research. How can students get hands-on involvement?
A couple of ways. If you're an admitted student, there are research opportunities between each of the years. If you have some success and want to continue, we'll try to make a way to continue. Also, if you try it and don't like it, that's okay too. You can at least later on in your career say, I tried research and didn't care for it.
Well, how does the hands-on activities work? Are they on their own or are they supervised?
Oh, very definitely supervised. Depending on whether they want to do clinical research or basic science research, we have faculty very capable in both areas.
How are students admitted to the college? Is it a rigorous process?
It is. For the past 5 years, U.S. News and World Report has rated dentistry as a top five career. This year, we have 100 slots in our class, and we had 1,772 applications for those.
Well, tell us what kind of classes are offered for the dentist students.
It's a four-year program. The first year is a mixture of basic science and dental sciences. Typically, you're taking 12 to 14 courses at a time. It's a rigorous program, especially the first three semesters. Once the third year starts, so you start moving into clinical care with the fourth year almost exclusively clinical care.
Well, after students graduate, what happens then? Do you see that they stay in Memphis with the UT Health Science Center, or do you see them branch out?
They usually branch out. About two-thirds of the class goes directly into private practice. The remaining third may go on to one of the six major specialties of dentistry.
Well, college definitely isn't cheap. What sort of scholarship opportunities do you have for students?
Strange enough, academic scholarships are not that plentiful. Our class is frankly made up of superstars, and so no one stands out in our classes like they might have in an undergraduate school. So we do have endowed scholarships, but nothing in way that would pay for an entire education.
Well, talk to us about the Hinman Student Research Symposium.
The Hinman meeting is a dental meeting. It's probably the best in the country, held in Atlanta every March. We developed a very close association with them, and they sponsor the National Student Research Symposium every October at the Peabody. And so every school who has significant research on a student basis sends their students for a long weekend of seminars and research presentations.
How would you say your students benefit from this?
Well, dentistry is evolving. All healthcare professions are, of course, evolving at all times. And the student who may have an interest and may have some facility and research will give them a leg up to pursue that if they wish to.
Talk to us about your post-dental graduate opportunities.
Well, we have on our campus the six major clinical residencies. There are actually two more, but they really don't need that big a program. Our six major residencies are pediatrics, orthodontics, oral surgery, prosthodontics, endodontics, and periodontics.
How do students pick what residency they want to go in? Is it a hard process?
It's just as difficult to get a residency as it is to get into dental school. After the third year of clinic is typically when they would apply for a residency. And based on their third year, they may or may not like a particular area. And so they can apply to that area and hopefully get in.
How do you prepare students for a residency program?
They basically prepare themselves. As you rotate through the different areas of dental practice, you find things that either you care for or maybe you don't care for. And so as that evolves, then you have to decide, do I want to go into general practice for the rest of my life or focus strictly on a specialty area?
What happens to students after they go through residency? Are they done with school by then?
They hope they're done with school by then because a residency adds 2 to 4 more years of dental education onto our 4 years here.
What would you say the college, what sort of impact does it have on Memphis?
We supply basically about 90% of the dentists in West Tennessee and about 70% of the dentists in Tennessee as a whole. Even though we're located here in the southwest corner, we have a long reputation of spreading our graduates across the state.
Do you give back to the community at all?
We do. We have several organizations that are very active, as we should be, in our community. And strangely enough, our number one charity has nothing to do with teeth at all. It's St. Jude Target House, where our students go and play with the children and cook meals and entertain them. And I would think that's kind of odd that our major charity is not a dentally related charity, but it's how the students feel about these children.
Well, what kind of success have your graduates had? Can you give us some examples?
Let's see. We have several graduates who entered Harvard's MBA program for advanced education. With the president of the American Dental Association has been a Tennessean. The president of the Hem and Dental meeting, the really nice meeting in Atlanta, has been a Tennessean.
How do you think that the college has grown over the past years? It's a very old college.
It's an old college. Our building is the same building I trained in over 30 years ago. When it came time to modernize it, we appealed to our legislature in Nashville, and they gave us $1 million to update and modernize our clinic. We appealed to our alumni, and they gave us $12 million. And so they feel like their education has been well spent, and their standing in their community is well deserved.
What do you think makes the College of Dentistry so unique?
I don't know about unique. I do know our strength is clinical dentistry, and it always has been, and I trust it always will be. There are certain schools that are known to educate academic dentists and dental scientists. That's not our strength. Our strength is strictly clinical dentistry.
What advice would you give to someone who is thinking about applying for the health center?
Make good grades. The competition is intense. I couldn't get in now. And strangely enough, many of our seniors who are doing well could not get in again. That's how quickly the markers have moved up. So I would say go to undergraduate school, major at whatever you want to major in, but do well.
Where do you see the Health College of Dentistry going in the future?
Well, as you may or may not know, there are only 2 dental schools in Tennessee. No one is building a lot of dental schools. They are hideously expensive things to do. And so I suspect we will not do anything other than expand our clinic. We have a second building coming, but we're anchored quite firmly in the medical center.
Well, Mr. Covington, thank you for being on our show today.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
We now have to take a short break. But when we come back, we will hear from 2 optometrists from the Southern College of Optometry. Stay with us.
Welcome to Germantown High School, an international baccalaureate creative and performing arts optional school, a destination school for students who are going places.
Our students are of the highest caliber when it comes to their academics and knowledge.
The IB program is a very rigorous program.
You were challenged in a way that you thought you couldn't be challenged. You succeeded something that other kids may not have thought they could do.
They're accepted to colleges that are just, dream colleges for so many people.
Germantown High School offers a CAPA program, the Creative and Performing Arts program.
When I first came here, I saw the television studio and I was just amazed at what all I saw.
Kids do everything, that they're taught every detail that has to do with theater arts and creative arts.
I love a lot of things about Germantown High School, but primarily what I love is the athletics. There's something exciting around every single corner.
We probably are one of the most diverse high schools in the state of Tennessee, maybe the United States.
I would never doubt about sending your child to Germantown High School.
This high school is something not like any other high school that we have.
There's definitely fun in the work. We find fun in everything we do.
You're watching the award-winning GHS-TV, a nationally recognized student television station.
Welcome back to Crosstalk. I'm your host, Sara Mayers. Previously, we heard from one of the best medical health science schools in Tennessee and in the nation. We will now hear from the Southern College of Optometry to see what this school has to offer in the practice and profession of examining the eyes. Joining me on set are Dr. Jennifer Smith and Dr. Jessica Fowler, two optometrists and residents from SCO. Ms. Smith, Ms. Fowler, thank you both for being on the show today.
Thank you so much.
Well, the College of Optometry is one of the best. Can you tell us the history?
So basically, it's been around 1911 when it began, and it's grown significantly since. We have an eye clinic that is one of the biggest in the nation, and we see a variety of patients, especially this particular population. It has grown substantially, and we probably house about 500 students at a time.
Ms. Fowler, can you talk to us about the opportunities given at the college?
Sure. The college, it's a private college, so I actually went to University of Alabama for my optometry, and I'm doing my residency here. But so at UAB, we actually were part of a larger school, so there was also medical school and dental, all of that. At SCO, it's actually just an optometry school, so we also have several different residencies. We're in primary care. There's pediatric, low vision, and vision therapy. And we also see a lot of ocular disease patients.
What about one-on-one mentorships?
Because it's such a small school, the teacher-to-student ratio is actually fairly small. I'm not sure what it actually is. Do you have any idea?
Maybe around 1 to 10-ish.
Mm-hmm. Well, Ms. Smith, the mission statement for the school is to educate the best possible healthcare providers. How do you feel the college achieves this statement?
The Southern College of Optometry is extremely hands-on. So we give our students the educational and academic background in the first 2 years, but we throw them head-on into the clinic very soon. So they are having clinical practice, they're seeing patients, they're putting all of their book work to practical purposes very early, and that really helps with striving to get the most excellent optometrist because you have all these patients that are seen in a large volume in Memphis.
What sort of new developments do you have going on?
So we actually just developed something called Tearwell. It is a clinic that's housed actually in the tower, and it's specifically for dry eye patients. Those dry eye patients that have chronic disease that is very debilitating for their lifestyle. And this is a new development that houses an amazing amount of technology and clinicians.
Well, Ms. Smith mentioned getting to work with patients as a student. Can you talk mm-hmm. about that experience?
I actually was not at the School of Optometry working with as a student. But as a resident, we get to work with a student at Church Health Center. We spend half of our time there. And we are also precepting students in the clinic in primary care. So we each have about 4 or 5 students, and we see about 10 patients at a time with those students. So it's really nice to give them our knowledge as residents that just graduated about a year ago.
Ms. Smith, can you talk about the hands-on experience that students get?
Yes, so students get to be in a variety of clinics. As Dr. Fowler said, we have a pediatric department, ocular disease, contact lens, low vision, vision therapy. So the students essentially rotate through all these disciplines so they can touch on each one of them and kind of find what is inspiring to them, as well as what they feel like is their niche. And that hands-on experience involves seeing roughly 6 to 7 patients a day, really depending on what department you're in.
How would you say the college differs from other optometry colleges?
So one of the things for me personally that I chose when attending, why I chose Southern College of Optometry is because the clinical aspect is so robust. A lot of other colleges are research-based, a lot of colleges are clinical-based, and being clinical-based basically means that your hands-on experience is the most important thing that the college offers. So again, the practical purposes of seeing patients day in and day out, doing diagnoses, treatments, and prognoses is really important. And I think that's something that SCO has that's very competitive with other optometry schools.
Ms. Faber, what about you?
I think the doctors that we get to work with, they're well known in the community of optometry, And it was really nice for me to switch from one school and work with other doctors as well. And then I also had more opportunities here to work in the community.
Well, tell us about what happens when students graduate. What's the next on their path?
So for us particularly, you have several opportunities. We have a Hayes Center of Practice Excellence, which actually pushes for opening your own private practice. As well, you can go into a residency, which Dr. Fowler and I are currently in. We're at the end of our first year. The residencies allow you to, again, go through all those disciplines, primary care for us, but if you enjoy working with children, the elderly, traumatic brain injury or that sort, then you can have that specific specialty or focus. A lot of people also work for the VA. We have a lot of optometrists here at the Memphis VA Association, as well as MD-OD practices, which are considered referral centers for LASIK or cataract surgery, things of that nature.
Ms. Fowler, would you say that students stay in Memphis after they graduate, or do they branch out more?
I think most branch out more. Memphis is, anytime you have a school in a city, you're going to have a little saturation of optometrists. It happened in Birmingham, it's happening here. People come here from all over the southeast. We're one of the only schools in the region, and so most people are going to usually go back home to practice.
Well, tell us about SCO's community outreach.
So we have a lot of outreach using Church Health Center, which actually is just moving to Crosstown, the old Sears mm-hmm. Tower. We spend half of our time there, and so we're seeing uninsured patients and getting to that demographic of the patients in the community. The students also work at nursing homes, and there's school screenings as well.
Well, the college donates more than $1.4 million to the community each year. Where does this money go towards?
A variety of things. Some of the things that we use that money for are some of our facilities that we then use for the public. So again, we have a mobilized bus. Some of that is donated in terms of a vehicle that travels to different school screenings or different areas that then provide full exams on the bus itself, which is equipped with an entire exam room. Also, we use that to basically promote awareness. Infancy, which is a program used to really promote the need for eye exams for infants and young children. And a lot of that money helps with going to give free eye exams to six-month-olds and the like, and let you know that children exams need to be done regularly. So a lot of it's awareness and preventative.
Ms. Fowler, college is quite expensive.
Yeah.
What sort of scholarship opportunities are given to students?
There's quite a few, and I think as you get further into your education each year, there's the opportunity to get more scholarships. There's also contract seats for certain states. So I am actually from Louisiana, and so Louisiana paid for half of my tuition at University of Alabama, and then I will go back to Louisiana for at least 6 years to basically pay them back for letting me go. SCO also has the same contract seats with a few of the surrounding states, as long as they don't have optometry schools in their state.
Well, Ms. Smith, Ms. Fowler, thank you both for being on the show today.
Thank you so much.
We have to take another break. But when we come back, we will talk with the assistant dean from the nursing program at the University of Memphis. Stay with us.
They said I have troll teeth.
That my voice sounded like a possessed baby doll.
That no one would ever love someone as stupid as me.
That I was fat, ugly,
disgusting.
The effect of bullying is potent.
We will no longer be the silent majority.
Now, when you see online bullying, there's something you can do about it.
We're gonna take action with the eye.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness, and so are you.
Oh, look, a redhead.
Staring contest.
You still got it.
I know. Come alive with the forest.
The dad was cute.
You were looking right at us.
Visit discovertheforest.org to find a forest near you.
You're watching the award-winning GHS-TV, a nationally recognized student television station.
Welcome back to Crosstalk. I'm your host, Sara Mayers. Join me on set now is Ms. Jennifer Hitt, the Assistant Dean of Nursing Students from the Nursing Program at the University of Memphis. She is here to provide insight about their program and what all goes into having a profession in the field of nursing. Ms. Hitt, thank you for being here today.
Thank you for having me.
Well, the college recently celebrated 50 years, so congratulations
on that. Thank you. We're very proud of that.
Can you tell us how the school celebrated?
Well, we're actually in the midst of a year-long celebration. we're having a variety of speakers come in, a variety of events. We're having a gala in October, and we're bringing back a lot of our alumni. We're having naming our 50 top leaders in nursing that were alumni from the University of Memphis.
Well, the school started with 27 students mm-hmm. back 50 years ago, and now it's over 1,000.
That's right.
Tell us how the school's grown.
Well, most nursing schools have grown recently because the need for nurses has grown. Our building changed last fall. We opened a new building, the Community Health Building. It's a little bit away from the university, but it's over 300,000 square feet, and it's one of the largest physical spaces for nursing programs in the Southeast.
Why do you think the program has grown to such capacity?
Well, the field of nursing has grown. There's going to be a nursing shortage here in Tennessee again within the next couple of years, it's predicted. But, you know, nursing is just a booming field, and the need is there, and I think the government realizes the need's there, and so they started to appropriate more money towards nursing schools to allow these programs to grow.
Well, the school was started in 1967. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us the history of how it began?
Well, I do know that there were two faculty when it first started, and like you mentioned, 20 students, and I think they had one classroom. If you notice anything about histories back then, most hospitals were the ones that ran nursing programs. And so this was one of the first BSN programs in West Tennessee, and it was kind of an outlier because most nurses went through these diploma programs, so to have a bachelor's degree was really a big thing back in the 1960s.
Well, one of your goals are student success. Mm-hmm. How are you ensuring this?
Well, we provide a quality in-class instruction. We also provide a lot of different clinical experiences. We have over 300 clinical sites throughout the city and in West Tennessee. We provide a great opportunity for students to work with simulators. We have a great simulator center, which students go in and practice their nursing skills prior to going into the clinical situations.
What type of courses do students take?
Well, when they go through nursing school, our traditional program is a 5-semester program, and they will start with a foundations course and learn nursing skills and health assessment. Then they'll move on to adult health. They'll take things like pediatric nursing, women's health nursing, mental health nursing, ICU nursing. So we kind of build on our curriculum as they go along to when they get to their 5th semester, they'll actually work in with a nurse one-on-one and complete a series of hours with them.
What sort of undergraduate programs do you have?
We have a variety of different ways that you can get your BSN. We have a traditional program, which is 5 semesters. We have an accelerated program, which is for people who have a bachelor's degree already to come in and get a second bachelor's degree. That's 4 semesters. And we also have a program for nurses that have associate degrees to come in to finish their bachelor's degree later on once they have already a registered nurse.
How are students admitted into this program?
Well, it's a pretty vigorous admission process. We had over 800 applicants for about 200 slots this past semester. We look at a variety of things. We look at overall college GPA. We also look at what we call our science GPA. So those are your science courses like anatomy and physiology and microbiology. We also have a program for incoming freshmen that if you're a high school senior and you have a 23 ACT and a 3.0 high school GPA, you can be guaranteed a spot in the program your sophomore year. So I do encourage if a high school senior qualifies for that to go ahead and apply for that so that they have a seat because it is very competitive.
What sort of financial aid do you offer to students?
Well, we offer about $200,000 in scholarships alone just from the school. A lot of our students will take out loans, and most hospitals have loan repayment programs for nurses. So the nurses go and work at these hospitals, and the hospitals pay back money as they work. There's also Nurse Corps, which is a federal government program that pays back nurses that work in underserved areas, which is pretty much all of Memphis.
Well, the U of M nursing program is incredible and it does great things.
Well, thank you.
Do you see many of your nurses stick around in Memphis or do they branch out to other communities?
Well, I would say about half usually stick around. We have nursing alumni all over the country and in fact all over the world that we hear from. But it's not hard to find a University of Memphis alumni nurse here in Memphis.
Well, what sort of research goes into the school?
We have kind of a new growing research program. A lot of our faculty have PhDs and are involved in clinical research. We have an asthma research project that's ongoing. We also have a variety of mostly community health type research programs that are going. If students want to get involved in that, we do have opportunities for both undergraduate and graduate students to get involved in the research.
What sort of hands-on experiences do students get?
Oh, they get a lot of hands-on experience. They start off their first semester. We don't send students into the hospital their first semester. They start by practicing on themselves and their partners. And then their second semester onward, they spend about 2 days each week in a hospital or clinical setting, hands-on with a clinical instructor. And it's a lot of hours and it's a lot of commitment.
What do you think makes the nursing school so unique and special?
I think it's our students that make it so unique. We have very dedicated students, and I feel that our students really present themselves well in the community, and it's not hard to find a University of Memphis student when you're out in a hospital setting. You typically will run into one, but I think that our commitment to nursing and to the profession and to the community really is what makes us so special.
What advice do you have for a student who's considering nursing?
I would say to study very hard once you get to college. Keep your overall GPA up, keep your science GPA up. Every program, to be quite honest, is getting very competitive. I don't think we're unique in that we have a lot of applicants for not as many spots. Mm-hmm. So no matter which nursing school you decide to go to, you're going to have a competitive overall GPA and science GPA.
And lastly, what sort of how do you give back to the community?
We have a variety of different programs. We have a foot clinic, which is for people that have diabetes and or foot ulcers at Church Health Center. We also have international programs where students go and practice internationally. We had a group that just came back from Central America. We are really just involved in a lot of different community activities, health fairs, and things like that.
Well, Ms. Hitt, thank you for being on our show today.
Thank you.
As you can see, there are many colleges and universities here at home that offer many different programs in the medical field. I hope this show has offered insight about medical schools in our area and that our guests have shown the many benefits and degree that a medical field can provide. Remember, Crosstalk can be seen each week at 9:30 a.m. and 7 p.m. on Mondays and Thursdays and 12:30 p.m. and 7 p.m. on Sundays. For more information on our programming, please check us out on the web at ghstv.org. We are streaming live 24 hours a day. You can also check us out on Facebook and Twitter. I'm Sara Mayers from all of us at GHS-TV. Thank you for watching Crosstalk and hope to see you again.